Welcome back. I'm the RPG Chick. Pelli-Eye here. Wants to get rid of the Sticha. This, I believe, is the head Sticha. Now, if I just walk back here, these ones will talk to me. They say shk stuff.
I am the very soul of action!
Because there's something back here. There's loot. Where? Right here. Oh, it's digging. Look at that. That's pretty cool. I like that. This tunnel is blocked by debris, but it's loose enough that a burrowing creature could easily push its way through.
I'm going.
As I tried to do for about 2 seconds. 12 shins. Nice. If there are shins, I will take them. Now, before I attempt to go into any other part of the tunnels, let's talk to this chiquette, who knows a few words and some sign language. Unfortunately, we don't know sign language, at least as far as I know. So what I'm trying to do is negotiate with this creature instead of, you know, killing them all and taking their eggs. This massive creature looms over you. That would probably take forever as well. A scent like lightning in an underground cavern washes over you, and it reminds you of nothing so much as curiosity. It chitters and rumbles, waving its large claws to an expressive dance. Something about these smells, sounds, and gestures seems familiar, a niggling itch in the back of your mind. At least you remember the taxonomy now. This is a Stichus, a huge burrowing insectoid, as we've already met one. It points to itself and says, "Chiquette." It follows with another stream of high-pitched noise. You almost have the sense of the language, the structure, the feel, the sound and scent. The itch in your mind intensifies. You can feel the memory of the Stitch's language waiting to reveal itself. Well, unfortunately, we can't do that. I'm trying anyway, but nope. Train title affinity skill. I should probably take this. Next time I can take a skill. Can you tell me about the Sticha? Genuine curiosity. It scrabbles briefly at the wall, and a bit of lightning flares about the crown of antenna on its head. Its shoulders shrug, and you smell dust. Can you tell me more about the Sticha? Its chitters and grumbles remain incomprehensible to you. It nods its head at you, and when you fail to respond, it trills, "Talk, other question!" What can you tell me about this place? It looks at you intently, and its spatulate fingers begin a slow and careful dance. The sounds it makes are slow chitters that rise and fall in pitch, accompanied by the smell of ozone. Good rock, full of electricity. It's good home, safe. It shuffles back and forth. What do you think of Pelli-Eye? The Sticha seems discombobulated for a moment. Who? Then it thinks a little more. Then it sprays out a blast of pheromones, and you smell the sharp tang of acid and weakened stone. It smells like distrust. Since when does weak stone and acid smell like distrust? We talk about Pelli-Eye again? The Stitches huffs out a barely visible cloud of moisture, and its faint odor is that of faulty eggs rotting under buried radiation. It seems that Chiquette doesn't trust Pelli-Eye at all. Don't blame you. I definitely, you know, I feel sorry for these things. I don't know what they're doing or why, but I feel sorry for them. That, I don't know. We have to work out something that's gonna work out. We have to make... I don't know. We have to work out something that'll benefit both the Sticha and the people of Cliff's Edge. I don't want to go someplace right now. I have come to ask you to stop digging underneath the city. Chiquette waves its arms around, and the air fills with the scent of a slow-growing fungus. You think it says, "Why?" More incomprehensible chittering follows, and then it speaks slowly and carefully. Not learn us speech! Not work us! No! Not now! We dig! Maybe I need this in order to... I don't know. The Stitches waves its arms and chitters uncomprehensibly. You can't understand what it's trying to say, except that it isn't willing to stop digging. Alright, you dig under the city, right? Can you take me someplace? Over the scent of warm gravel, the Stitches clicks and whistles. You understand the words, yes, and shins. What do the Stitcher use shins for? It points to various items on your belt in person, and you think it's telling you that the Stitcher buy items from a human. Yeah, from, what's her name? Written down, I think. Mikella. Over that way. No, I'm not gonna ask this. Oh! We haven't there's a ledge that we can't get to. Can you bring me to the ledge and cliff's edge? It's like this little area. Over the scent of warm gravel, the Stitches clicks and whistles. You understand yes and pay. You know, yeah, what the hell, let's go there. I still have to explore the rest of this area. I have to explore not the foundry. I'm thinking of Planescape Torment. Crap. It's up over that way. People work there. I can't remember the name of it. It's like I don't know. Let's pay 10 shins. Let's hope it's worth it. We go! I don't know what a thing like that would sound like, but it says high and chittering, and that's the best I can do. Where the hell are we? Oh, we're down here. I wanted to go over here. I wonder if we're gonna get up there. Oh, there's some eggs. Okay. There's a huge toilet over here. I got loot here. Hope it's more than 10 shins. 56 shins! And a special axe. Quick ice axe. Ooh, nice. It's expensive. 8 physical damage, 7 chemical damage, plus 1 damage per effort applied to a max of plus 3. On hit confers bleeding, which is 6 damage per turn, active 2 rounds. When powered, the axe blade is covered in a thin layer of extraordinarily sharp ice that bites deep into foes. Now, if we didn't have mystical lore, we wouldn't have any of all this. Legends tell of young Kel, who found this axe in its original shape. I thought this whole thing was going to start rhyming. His belief was that this device would finally allow his vengeance on the Fire Whites of Ossifagan. He refashioned the material into a blade and fastened it to a pole, etching into it characters written in a tongue no other could decipher. Even this mighty weapon could not stand against the Fire Whites, but had served in many battles since, deadly against all other foes. Nice.
You are a fine traveling companion, Tiber.
It warms my cockles to you.
I can use you as a test before I explain my ideas to others. If you can understand me, anyone can.
Oh, burn. Hopefully you guys could hear that. Should use him as a test against, first different against people. If he can understand her, anyone can. Okay, so she's using the buzzer. That's where we saw that before. He's using a broadsword. And he's using a great sword. This gives you more damage per effort applied. But only to a max of plus 2. I think I'm gonna give him the axe. Inability with heavy weapons for Tybeer. Same for Calistege and myself. So it's pretty clear who can use it. Alright, so... Now if I want to give something to someone, I think I just go like this. This is the first time I've done that. How do you like that? Cool. Nice. Okay, so what's this thing?
Ready.
A faint droning sound resolves into a rhythmic churning hum as you approach the strange machine. Of course we're going to examine it. An ovoid opening lined with a metallic wire mesh dominates the front of the device, and through it you catch the faintest glimpse of swirling liquid. Atop the machine rests a dome of translucent material and a brilliantly lit sphere. Let's examine the sphere. The glowing sphere appears solidly attached to the rest of the machine. The light dims as you move your hands close to it. You spend a few moments moving your hand all around the sphere, and eventually you discover that its light seems to dim as your hand gets closer to a fixed point directly in front of it. Alright, before I do any of that, let's examine the dome. On closer inspection, you notice the dome contains what appears to be a human brain, but it's several times larger than a normal brain. Okay, I guess this is a sphere and this is a dome. It floats serenely within the enclosure, pulsing occasionally, but you can find no way to interact with it. Let's examine the wire mesh. The mesh appears to prohibit direct contact with the fluid jostling around the device's interior. Curiosity must have gotten the better of someone, however, as a line has been sliced cleanly through the bottom of the mesh. The opening created by the slash appears roughly large enough to reach an arm into it. What happened to the person who put their arm in there? Let's tap the dome. You knock lightly on the dome, which triggers a minor convulsion from the brain within. However, nothing else happens. You knock on the dome once more, and the brain again reacts, but other than possibly tormenting the entrapped organ, you accomplish nothing. Pass your hand in front of the sphere. The sphere's light dims, then brightens again as your hand completes the motion. From within the machine, you hear the strangled sound of evacuating liquid. The constant humming sound of the machine has stopped. Pass your hand in front again. The sphere's light dims and brightens as usual, but other than a dry clicking sound, nothing else occurs. You lightly knock on the dome, triggering a minor convulsion from the brain within. A swooshing sound erupts from the interior of the device, and it resumes its former rhythmic hum. This could be some, like, toilet bowl. And it's flushing when you pass your hand in front of it. Because we got a swooshing sound, and we got liquid. Reach through the opening. Hope we don't find a turd. Your hand splashes into an oily fluid as you plunge it through the hole in the mesh. As you probe around the interior, you momentarily feel something solid brush against your hand. You blindly grope for the object, but it proves quite difficult to grab. Attempt to grab the object in the fluid. I went all the way this time. Ooh, I got a ring. It's not a fettle, is it? Not a fettle, a thing? Why do we pick up... We pick up these things and they automatically go there. Now we got Cypher Sickness, symptoms increasing, minus 15% on all tasks. After a few near misses, you manage to get a firm grip on the object and remove it from the machine. Yep. Ring of El Amor. Your hand meets nothing but air. The sides of the inner tank are still slick with whatever fluid previously filled it. Oh wait, doesn't the sphere... There's nothing else. The sphere's light dims and brightens as usual, but other than a dry clicking sound, nothing else occurs. Rushing liquid resumes within the device. Your hand immediately plunges into an oily liquid. You swish it to and fro, but find nothing. Alright. Alright. Yeah, look at that. Ring of El Amor. Cancels the next negative fettle applied to this character. Well then why doesn't it cancel the fettle that we're getting from wearing it? Excludes flanked and lasting damage, and deals 5 chemical damage to the attacker. One use. This serpentine ring seems like a small thin snake wrapping itself thrice around an invisible finger. Its head features 2 indigo jewels for eyes that look like trapped lightning, and a gaping mouth with 2 sharp fangs bared to strike. The ring protects the wearer by absorbing any status effect from the bloodstream and converting it into a weapon. A blood needle that can be shot at any living creature. That's pretty freaking cool. Mystical. Specialized. Lore. The ring is the symbol of a lost cult that worshipped the mythical serpent El Amor. This cult specialized in making poison and crafted these devices from a cache of ancient Numenera within their temple. It is said that they once controlled the far north of the Ninth World for a brief period, and legend insists that the mention of El Amor still strikes terror in the hearts of some of the inhabitants of that area. I want to get rid of you. Whenever I get in some kind of battle, I'm going to use this, but... could be another 16 hours before I can get in battle again. I really don't want this stuff weighing me down until then. And I don't want to kill all the Sticha and destroy their eggs. I don't want to do that either. We have to do something for them. I'm gonna try something. Save, return. If I discard this item... Can I discard it and give it to someone else? Because I don't know how to... Oh, I did it. Okay, cool. He can only have one. So we'll give him unstable detonation. What else might I... So we only have... -2 to speed pull now. This is neat, I like that. Is it passive? Consumes movement. So I have to use it. Now, if I wanted to... Yeah. She said something, I think. I'm gonna hear it. So I could just have people hold on to these ciphers for me. This, fresh vapors. I think we found this way out in the Reef of Fallen Worlds, I think it's called. Give it the Calistige. Now I have no negative. Whenever I need to use it, just give it back to myself and immediately use it, and I'll be fine. She can hold two more. And he can only hold one. And he can hold two. Cool. So, as long as these characters don't leave us unexpectedly, or I forget, either one. So let's go back. Nothing else to see here, right? I wish I could go... I want to go here. Whatever this is here. That's where I thought we were going. So see where we end up. We come back out. And end up back where we were, or navigating through these tunnels. Or back where we were. Okay. Burrow through. Okay, will it let me? Because there's more stuff here.
Fine.
Loot! Nice. 13 more shins.
Of course.
Loot, of course. So we now have 275. So he has all the kids doing their work for them. So I have to come back.
I'm going.
Pelii, a Vargellan agent of the slave families, is trying to stop the Sticha from digging underneath the city. Apparently, the creatures are destabilizing Sega's cliffs and causing buildings to collapse. Her negotiations have gone nowhere, so she's turned to less honorable tactics. Pelii wants me to steal all the Sticha eggs from their lair so that the city can use them as a bargaining chip. She'll also accept a negotiated settlement with the Sticha, if I can somehow bring one about, but she doesn't believe that such a settlement is possible. When I asked about an alternative means to reach the Sticha lair, Pelii suggested I look for some sort of digging construct, or find someone skilled in manufacturing who can fabricate one. Oh, that goes up to Government Square. That goes to Dendrohurt Chapel. Before I go messing around in there, let's continue with our exploration here.
Yes, now.
Okay, I guess now. Manufactory, that's what I was trying to think of. Check out the Manufactory. Good to see you. Well, they like me now. Oh, nice. Thugs like me. Not sure what that says about me. Don't know why he's got a shout all the time. Can't talk. Gotta fetch scrap for the smiths. Inch noisy here. Someone's whistling. Stalkers, reset the staging doors. He grumbles. Well, there's our thing. Our thing that can dig. There are worse ways to spend a day. A bit warm, though. This ancient ship is embedded in the rock, and only its lower portion is visible here. The workers are using its roaring engines as a smelting furnace. Interesting. Hundreds of broken Numenera are piled here. The workers are scavenging them for parts if they're useful, or throwing them into the furnace if they're not. Petros, the synthsmiths need more ore. So I can interact with that and that. Cleaners, check the steam vents. He groans. We can interact with all these. Energies from this massive engine are channeled into metal pipes, sent below ground, and distributed throughout underbelly. I can interact with that thing as well. You're looking for work here? Hope you like heat, loud noise, and a pissy metal boss. Alright, let's mess with this thing. This Tarnish, he must be the boss. Oh, cool. It's a ladder?
All right.
A set of floating rungs rises from the floor, leading up to a more conventional ladder built into the side of the ancient ship. The ladder disappears into darkness above. Huh? Let's talk to the boss first. I'm having trouble. Tarnish. That's an interesting name. The elderly man stares vacantly at a distant wall, muttering under his breath. His hands flex on the air, twisting and tweaking as if he is repairing a machine only he can see. He jumps when you draw in a breath to speak. Yes? What? He says. His eyes rove past you, halt, then return to focus on your face with some effort. Ain't you a quiet one? He says cheerfully. The underforeman makes more noise than you. We should hang chimes from your ears to keep you from surprising people. What do you need? What do you do here? I take care of my master, he says simply. The underforeman. There used to be more of us when he was making things, but when he lost interest, the master foreman, he jerks a yellow thumb at the construct at the center of the chamber, hired them all, offered them more. Tarnish spits on the ground. Happened a while back, but I don't forget a slight. He thinks, he's a good foreman, maybe the best, if he didn't have this fool idea in his head. What do you do here again? I take care of my master, he says, blinking. Take care of him as best as I can. Why do you keep calling your master he? I've worked for him a long time. Guess I stopped seeing him as a thing, and more like a him. He shrugs. All of us have our little ways, even him. What's a foreman? Well, they are, he says, flapping his hand around the cavernous foundry. The constructs. They're frozen in their tracks, but they run this place together. The constructs who run this place, he squints at you. Didn't you ask me that already? How long have you worked with the foreman? Couldn't say, he says, his brow furrows. On my first day, I'd already met my wife, but she was still married to... what's his name? With the fishhook tattoo. And I hadn't lost a finger and grown it back yet, so... He peers at the ceiling, mouth working. 70 years? Give or take? I should retire, but there'd be no one left to mind him if I left. He thinks, what would I do with myself anyway? Could be more than 50 years, he says firmly. 80 years? Could be that. Could be 80. You know, I really don't remember. Alright, so the boss is in the middle of the room. Let's talk to this one.